So how is the circuit computed about understanding? So this current, so the electrons are escaping to infinity. So are the
Let's say electrons are escaping from somewhere and protons are escaping somewhere else. So they go to infinity, but if you allow them to do that, the surface will become negatively charged at one point and positively charged at another point.
Yeah.
Right. So inside the surface, then the current will, you know, because charges are free to move, current will ensue to restore balance to the to the charge distribution which initially had the Hilbert frequency. So when you lose charge, then that is balanced by a current across the field lines.
So the circuit has been completed on the surface of the neutron star?
Yes.
But there are positive charges going in one direction, negative charges going in another.
Not necessarily. At the light cylinder, charges are moving away, right? And the sign of charge that moves away from here is different than the sign of charge that moves away from there. So you are losing both kinds of charges. In reality, you will have electrons and positrons, not protons. So both components of pure plasma are going out. So you will, if you don't compensate for the loss of charge by motion of charges on the surface, then you will get additional charge building up.
That's all. So near the proton cap in this particular case, there is, it's losing negative charge. So negative electrons.
So this critical line, above the critical line, it is going to lose one sign of charge. Below the critical line, it is going to lose another sign of charge.
Yes.
Right. Yes, but in polar cap region, the open magnetic field lines, this is the 55 degree angle, right?
Yeah.
This null charge surface.
Yes.
But our polar cap size is much smaller.
But that doesn't matter. It is the critical line is where this 55 degree line intersects the light cylinder. Yeah. And the field line passing through that is the critical line.
Yeah, now that is...
So that will certainly land within the
negative charge.
Within the polar cap.
Yeah, within the polar cap, but it is preferentially in the region where negative charge accumulates, right, in the electrosphere.
Negative charge accumulates well above that, right? So it's this is not the electrosphere solution. In electrosphere solution, there is no movement of charge. So this is Goldreich-Julien solution, which is different from electrosphere solution, right? In electrosphere, there is no current, no charge movement, so and there is no charge all the way, going all the way to the light cylinder.
But the charge separation is the same. The positives are on one side of this null surface and negatives on the other side.
That is correct. So, but there is large region around the null surface which is actually empty in electrosphere.
Right.
In Goldreich-Julien, it is not. In Goldreich-Julien, they have charge everywhere, and you have excess of one over the other. In most of the regions.
So in so the field lines which is passing through the light cylinder, the signature of that means the charge signature of that particular field line from the Goldreich-Julien distribution will determine what kind of charge will flow out.
Correct. So ultimately charges are flowing out from here, from the light cylinder.
Yeah.
Right? And the local charge, sign of charge will matter. Now, this may mean that positive charges will have to travel through a cloud of negative charges and then come here, right? So basically there is a excess of negative charge or positive charge in this region.
Mm-hmm.
And then that will change and will become excess of positive charge or negative charge in this region. And then whatever stands here will flow out. And then you have to supply that. Because you are losing that from the field line. So to supply that, you have to find the charges somewhere and then feed it back. If you don't, then it will then start accumulating charges.
So since it's a continuous flow, it's allowed to have this positive charges in this region flowing out through the light cylinder.
Yes. So it's a continuous flow, then you can get a continuous current.
I couldn't understand about what you said about the excess charge. How does this excess charge, what is the concept? Like,
if you take one sign of charge from one particular region of the surface and keep moving them out, then that part of the surface will become oppositely charged.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yes.
And that, there is a certain charge distribution which leads to E dot B equal to zero. If the charge distribution differs from that, then E dot B will no longer be equal to zero. So you will have forces which the local charges will feel. And the local charges will move because of that force. So if you disturb that original charge equilibrium, original charge distribution, then you will get flow of charges, which is going to constitute the current.
I had another question. You said something about radiation reaction yesterday, that radiation reaction is not important. So
not included.
Not included.
We have not included radiation reaction, for example, in the motion of charges. We have not included inertia in the motion of charges. So here, charges are being taken practically massless and not impeded by any other force. So once you do that, then there will be some departure from the solution that we are talking about.
So how does the radiation reaction overflow for a movement of relativistic charges?
Yes.
How does it work? Like,
it will tend to slow it down. It's a damping.
Okay,
so it's a deceleration on the charge.
Okay, so is this a good approximation here?
Yes, it is a fairly good approximation. Because the charges don't end up losing very much of their linear motion once they have come to the lowest Landau state. They don't lose a large fraction of their energy while transiting through the magnetosphere. They lose a bit, but not while transiting through the magnetosphere. They will lose a lot of energy, as we will see, once they go out of the light cylinder. And all that will come. In this model of the magnetosphere, we have taken it as completely. There are no forces other than the Lorentz forces on the charge, and there is no inertia. And that is the meaning of force field. Again, I'll define force field today. Yes. To recall again, then what we have had in the Goldreich-Julien picture is that you will have this co-rotating magnetosphere where you have the Goldreich-Julien charge density populated everywhere, and it co-rotates. There is no net motion of charged particles along the field lines. And this co-rotation, as we just discussed, gives you a azimuthal current. And this azimuthal current actually adds to the magnetic moment of the star. So the field lines will look slightly different than your original dipole field lines you started with because of the field produced by the azimuthal current. But remember, there are charges of both signs in different regions. But they're all moving in the same direction. So therefore, overall, when we integrate over the magnetosphere, this effect is quite small. But depending on how you populate the magnetosphere, the values could be different. Because it is not necessary that the entire magnetosphere is all, everywhere populated with Goldreich-Julien charge. It is possible that there are places where there are no charges. The one sign of charge could be underpopulated, other sign of charge could be overpopulated. So depending on how the charge population goes, you will have more or less effect on the net magnetic moment of the star. But overall, this effect is small. But it is there. And similarly, in the open field lines, we have seen that the charges will move, and as the charges move, you create a polaroidal current, and that polaroidal current will create a toroidal magnetic field, and this toroidal magnetic field will add to the original dipole field, and you will have now distortion in the azimuthal plane of the field line. And we also discussed how the field lines could be populated with charges, and we found that pair production happens quite easily, and they can cascade, and you can get a large multiplicity of charges. So in general, what is going to happen in the magnetosphere is that you will have, let's say, in the force field limit, the Goldreich-Julian charge density being populated, but the number density of charges could be much, much larger than the charge density. So it's only the difference between the number density of charges of the two signs that then give you the Goldreich-Julian charge density. So multiplicity of charges could be very, very large in the pulsar magnetosphere. And this pair plasma, which is now populating the magnetosphere, on the open field lines, they can then escape and then arrive in the surroundings, populate the nebula around it, and then produce the pulsar wind nebula emission that we see. Another thing we also noticed yesterday, that if you have this kind of accelerator in the pulsar magnetosphere, you very quickly accelerate particles to very large energies. So you get relativistic motion. And relativistic motion causes the emission from the particles to be directed along the velocity of the particle. And in the end, since the particles are practically moving along the field lines, so you have the beams of emission which are propagating along the field lines locally. And as the field lines widen, then the emission from different points of the field line will then have different cone width. And this is what is used to explain the radius to frequency mapping. So as you go to lower frequencies, your emission is coming from regions which are further away from the surface, and the tangent to the field lines there are wider, but the charges are still relativistic and moving along the field line, so therefore the radiation is along the field line. So the cones become wider as you go to larger altitudes.
Yeah. Why does it happen? Why does the cone become wider?
Because the dipole field lines diverge, right? The field geometry is such that the angle is smaller near the polar cap, and as they go up, they diverge. So if you take a tangent there and a tangent here, the cone angle will be different. Right? Let me go back to this picture. So you take this field line, if you take tangent here and a tangent there, the cone angle is different.
So line of sight is cutting through these field lines?
Yeah.
So as we go to higher, at a distance higher from stellar surface, it is cutting the divergent field lines.
So if you look at the picture from the pulsar's point of view, so you have a beam which is wider and wider at larger and larger altitudes. Your line of sight will cut through it, depending on your angle with respect to the spin axis. And if the beam is wider, it will give you a longer traverse through the beam than if the beam is narrower, right? So you will have a longer duration of the pulse if the beam is wider than if the beam is narrow, where you will get a shorter duration of the pulse. Okay, so now, let us try to look at the characteristics of the force-free magnetosphere. we have said that locally we have looked at the Kolmogorov-Julian solution and we have made E dot B equal to zero and seen the consequences of that. Force-free magnetosphere stands for a plasma field solution of the magnetosphere where the net Lorentz force on the charge distribution is zero everywhere. Okay, so all over the force-free magnetosphere, you have charge density times electric field plus current cross magnetic field by C is equal to zero. So that is the necessary condition of a force-free magnetosphere. And this then follows from the fact that E dot B will have to be zero in this case. So in case of the Pulsar magnetosphere, to sustain the magnetosphere, you need some E dot B. Otherwise, there will be no charges coming out. Otherwise, there will be no currents produced in the magnetosphere. But that E dot B is so small that we can still treat the pulsar magnetosphere as a force-free magnetosphere, and we can say that E dot B is very nearly equal to zero. It's so near to equal to zero that in case of a global magnetospheric solution, we are going to ignore the presence of this E dot B, which eventually leads to population of the magnetosphere with particles. So you don't worry about in the force-free magnetosphere the source of particles.
Yeah, this is only once it gets populated.
Yes.
Once it gets populated, it ideally it should be E dot B completely zero. Once it gets completely populated and a stable,
if you have no loss of particles.
No loss of particles, nothing. It yes. should be ideally zero.
Yeah, but we have seen that you cannot have no loss of particles either.
It has to flow.
It has to flow.
You have to give a little bit of.
So you will have a small amount of E dot B which you will ignore. When you talk about force free magnetosphere, all E dot B values are ignored. And this is true all over the magnetosphere. Gaps and so on are not entertained. And charge density, of course, you can then derive from del dot E by 4 pi. And the other thing which is an essential component of the force-free electrodynamics is that the inertial part of the energy, so that is kinetic energy, that's mass density times C squared. This is the rest energy of the particles, the inertia, is so small compared to the magnetic energy density that we ignore the inertia altogether and we treat it as though the rest mass of the particles are zero. Okay, so this is the essential element of the force-free magnetosphere, yeah? And this has been quite popular in trying to describe the pulsar electrodynamics right from the beginning, and it's been developed to more and more sophistication over time. Okay, so now in trying to obtain a description of the force-free magnetosphere for a pulsar, what people have started with is what's called a fully axisymmetric situation. Now this axisymmetric situation is such that we start with, let us say in this case, magnetic field axis parallel to the rotation axis. But even before we come to rotation, let's try to describe the axisymmetric magnetic field. An axisymmetric magnetic field can be uniquely described by two functions, two quantities. which are known as the flux function, is given here, and current function. Once these two are specified, an axisymmetric magnetic field, all components of it can be fully described in terms of this. The definition of these are the following. So let's take in cylindrical coordinates, you have R, phi, z coordinate system. So let's start to draw this. So let's take a circle of radius r at a height z. This angle will be phi. The net magnetic flux passing through this circle of radius r is called this flux function psi of r. And this value can change if I change the height. So this is a function of R and Z. Okay? And then the other function is, if you have colloidal currents in the system, then the net amount of colloidal current passing through the same circle is written as 2 pi I, which is also a function of R and Z. And now, since both are related to the same circle, and each circle is defined by a unique value of psi, this 2 pi I can be also written as a unique function of psi. Okay? This function psi, is it clear what it is?
Yeah, that's the flux through that circular cross section.
Correct. So that circle, then I can label as a value of psi.
Right.
Correct? A different circle will have another value of psi. Right? So it's a unique mapping. Each circle has a certain value of psi. This current is the total amount of colloidal current passing through this very same circle.
But wouldn't different circles have same value of psi?
No. You can check that unless the field happens to be totally parallel.
So it's basically tracing the dipolar field line. You're saying that as it's diverging,
dipolar or monopolar field line, yes.
Whatever field line we have, and we are tracing the circle, connecting the field lines, and then creating this circular area.
Right. Correct.
How does the 2 pi I psi come?
So I'm going to label this as psi.
Okay, the circle is psi. Label.
Yes. So the I is as a function of R and Z, because it is defined on the same circle, I can write it as 2 pi I as a function of psi. Okay. So now the poloidal magnetic field can be uniquely written as this quantity. It's grad psi by R times E phi. Grad psi cross E phi by R. So grad psi cross E phi is toroidal unit vector. So cross product of that will always give you the poloidal polar liquid.
Why are you writing it like that?
Why are we writing like that? I'm saying that the psi can be used to write the polar magnetic field uniquely.
Okay.
In this manner. The gradient of, or let's say if I take one circle and the next circle, the difference in psi between the two is the amount of flux between the two circles.
Right.
Right? So, you know, I now divide by the distance. So you will get, divide by the distance and divide by R. You'll then get the field itself at that point, the polar field. So that's what this grad psi, which is the difference between the value of psi between two circles divided by the distance between the circles, divided by R. It then gives you the local magnetic field. It is uniquely defined in cylindrical coordinates. Once you define the psi function, the polar magnetic field can be uniquely written in this form for axisymmetric systems. This is an expression for axisymmetric field. The field is not axisymmetric, then you cannot use these potentials in this manner. And similarly, the d phi can be written as just I by R.
This psi is B times A integral over the area.
But B varies.
Yeah, yeah.
So integral of
over the
B ds, yes. That's correct. Okay. Now, since this is axisymmetric, all derivatives which involve phi go to zero. Okay? So now we can go back to the force free magnetosphere conditions and also add to it that divergence B is zero. So now you have divergence B is 0 will imply divergence of the polar magnetic field being 0. So divergence of this being 0. And we use this force free condition. After some algebra, you will be able to get this. Those two written in one equation of this form, where RLC is the light cylinder radius, R and Z are the two coordinates, phi derivatives go to zero, this is the flux function, this is again the flux function, and this is the current function. So the force free condition leads to this equation, and since the rotating force free magnetosphere is the one which you think is applicable to pulsars, this equation actually goes by the name the pulsar equation. It is written in azimuthal coordinates, that cylindrical polar coordinates, but coordinate transformation is easy. So you can always write it in terms of spherical polar coordinates. You will have derivatives in r and theta in that case. There is no phi derivative even in there. Question is how to solve it. If you can solve it, then you have your magnetosphere. There is no solution, no analytical solution that is available for this pulsar equation for dipole magnetic fields. However, it was shown by Michael that if you assume the magnetic field to be monopole, then there is a very easy solution to the to the Pulsar equation.
Then divergence of V won't be...
Yes, come to that. So, but of course monopoles don't exist.
Yeah.
So, what you do is, you make the system a split monopole solution. One half of the hemisphere is one pole, other half of the hemisphere is another pole. And you have a current sheet in between so that you prevent the field lines joining up from one pole to another. So you have a split monopole solution, which is like a dipole, but at the dipole equator you put an infinite current sheet. So you have split the solution into two monopoles. And you can then apply the same monopole solution to each half. You just need to change the signs appropriately. Now, before I go to that solution, let's take a step back one moment and let's take a look at what we discussed about the wind zone of the Goldreich-Julien solution. We said that there is plasma moving out in the Goldreich-Julien wind zone. We also said that since field lines are open at large distance, field lines will be radial. Now, what kind of source gives you radial field lines?
Point source and where you have a diverging field. Like, say, you have a single charge, a point charge, it will give you a radial field line. So now you can say that in case of so that's why he's saying that you take a magnetic monopole and you get a 1 by R type of field out.
So, once you have a radial field, then you will know that since the flux is conserved, you take distance R. This cone area will keep increasing as R square, and the flux being conserved, the field will drop as 1 by R square, right? Whereas if it was a dipole field, it would drop as 1 by R cubed. So in the wind zone, in Goldreich-Julien solution, asymptotically, fields become radial and the polarity of field drops as 1 by R square. And if we go back to the Goldreich-Julien solution, you will see that. Vp is radial, I didn't write it here, but this will go as 1 by R square. And Bt, the toroidal field, as you can see, that it's got 1 R multiplying the polarity field. So Vg goes as 1 by R. And the field that goes as 1 by R is what we consider akin to a radiation field. And it's the toroidal field then which carries away energy to infinity and not the polarity. So similar thing will happen here if we consider the geometry to be split monopole. So the split monopole will share features of the dipole magnetosphere in the wind zone and at large distances. Of course, close to the origin, the geometry will be different. But it will share features with the dipole magnetosphere at large distances, which is why it is useful to study this. So let's see how the split monopole magnetosphere will look like. So as I said, the split monopole is such that you have one half with one pole, this is an off pole here, and one half with the other pole, let's say south pole there. And you have field lines going out radially all through, and it emerges in the direction is outwards in one hemisphere and the direction is inwards in the other hemisphere. And this is then divided by a current sheet. If the current sheet was not there, then this field line will try to turn around and join up over here. This current sheet prevents that from prevents it from doing so. So assuming that you have a monopole or a split monopole, in a non-rotating magnetosphere, where there is no spin, you know that the poloidal field, which is actually the radial field, will drop as 1 by r squared. This is like Coulomb field. Now, in the split monopole solution, it can be shown that even when you have rotation, the poloidal component of the field still continues to behave the same way. It still remains radial and still drops as 1 by r squared. Now remember, we did this formulation of the pulsar equation by putting a description of the field which is axisymmetric. But we did not impose a strong condition that the field has to be axisymmetric around the spin axis. Okay. So you can actually solve the pulsar equation by putting spin axis wherever you want. Your axis of symmetry that is used in that expression is the axis of symmetry of the magnetic field. Okay. And the split monopole solution actually retains all its features even for an oblique rotator. Okay. The toroidal field is this. The theta component goes to zero. The field remains radial. Toroidal component is this, which is actually very similar to the expression saw in Golden-Jurian solution. It is basically the poloidal field, which is b star by r squared, times r, so it remains as b star by r. Let's look at what it really means. The poloidal field remains radial. The toroidal field is actually just v phi by c times br. V phi is omega r sine theta, so that's where this comes from. The radial component of the electric field is zero. After all, we are trying to solve force free magnetosphere, E dot B has to be zero. E theta is equal to B phi and E phi is zero. Okay? So there is no electric field which is parallel to the magnetic field. So there is an electric field which is perpendicular to the magnetic field. There is no P5. The field is in R5 plane, but electric field has only a component in the theta plane, in theta direction.
What is V5?
V5 is the circular velocity of rotation. Right? Is omega r sine theta. Okay, so now that you have this, you can then ask what is the current J. J is now C by 4 times del cross B. You use the expression for B and you will find this to be omega dot B by 2 pi times ER, which is the unit vector along the radial direction. So the current is radial. And this, once you take electric field and do del dot E and find the charge density, then you find that this is nothing but C times rho times ER. So charge density is just omega dot B by 2 pi C. So that means the effective outward drift speed of the charges is C. Radial drift. Sustain this current. And then you can also, now that you have E and B, you can compute the pointing vector. And the pointing vector you can then integrate over the surface enclosing this and then find the net loss of energy and you get a significant loss of energy, which is the spin down rate, which is powering the subject. Now E cross B drift can be computed by taking Vt is equal to C E cross B by V square. And this is these two components, one is along R, one is along phi. This is 1 plus RLC by R square. This is 1 by R by RLC square. So at large R, this thing will drop down. The toroidal component of the drift will drop down. And at large R, the radial component of the drift will go to speed of light. So given this, you can then compute the gamma drift, that is the Lorentz factor that this drift velocity produces. It is square root of 1 by 1, R by RLC square. So that means as you go to R much less, much greater than RLC, you'll get the drift speed of the bulk wind going to large values of Lorentz factor. So this is what the split monopole solution says. Well, little pictorial representation of this. So you have a radial toroidal component and a toroidal component. When you put that together, you get the net field lines. And the field lines look like this. They start out radial and then they wind around. This is the light signal. The red lines are emerging from one hemisphere, the blue lines are emerging from the other hemisphere. The drift velocity, there is, yeah. Your question?
Yeah. So this is the solution for this.
That is correct. Correct.
And these field lines do not do anything special with the light cylinder, and it just extends all
the way. Yeah, it will just extend, and the toroidal component will increase, and it will just keep getting spiraling, spiraling out. As you go further down, this thing will just continue to spiral outwards.
It's time dependent in that sense, or?
It's a stationary solution. So the pattern is stationary in time.
Technically, this solution is valid only in the wind zone region.
Technically, this solution is valid everywhere if you have split monopole.
No, but we don't have.
No, no. You're asking whether this resembles a dipole.
It resembles?
A dipole solution. So, where will this resemble a dipole solution?
Okay.
So, that is the question you're asking. You're not asking whether the solution is valid. Solution is valid. But solution is valid for split monopole.
Yeah.
In what context you can use it to describe a dipole is what is the question that you are asking. So we'll come to that in a moment. Okay. So the drift speeds for charges, the pulsar wind speed, basically the phi component, as I said, it increases and then it drops, and then the radial component keeps increasing its speed with Lorentz factor starting small and going up to large values as you go to large distances. Now, this E cross B drift velocity, if you want to look at fully charged separated magnetosphere and talk about drift velocity of individual charges, then you will find that there is a contradiction. You need the charges to co-rotate in the magnetosphere. So E cross B drift must allow that to happen. So, to get a full solution then, but if you look at V phi, it's omega r, but as you approach the light cylinder, it departs. The azimuthal component. And similarly, the component of the drift velocity along the polar lines you have E dot B equal to zero everywhere. So how are you able to accelerate the charges to this kind of drift velocity? You're going to see large distances, and even at light cylinder you are up to pretty high speeds, but you have said that E dot B is zero, and this gives an acceleration, right? So it starts from low value of drift velocity along the field line and goes up. How is it possible with no electric field parallel to the magnetic field? So you should not look at this as an individual single particle picture. This is a fully plasma filled magnetosphere, and it's a plasma solution. the plasma has energy in the stored energy in kinetic energy in magnetic energy and so on. One form of energy can transform itself into another form of energy. So internal energy transforming itself into fluid velocity. It is not individual particles being accelerated due to local potential. Okay? So the picture won't work very well if you have fully charged separated magnetosphere which you want to describe by individual particles. The solution actually describes a situation where you have a large multiplicity of charges. So if the charge density is some, the actual number of charges are much, much larger than that. So you are very much in the plasma regime and not in the individual particle regime.
But he doesn't talk anything about this conversion of the which component of the internal energy is producing this bulk velocity. It's just taking that there is a conversion, it's just throwing
it back at a higher. You can work that out also. You can work out the local magnetic energy density in the plasma and kinetic energy density in the plasma, and then you can see the conversion.
So local magnetic energy at each and every point we can calculate from this BP and B phi, right? And then take it as that B square by 8 pi, that will give me the local and the kinetic
energy. No, there's also electric field. So,
yeah, so
there's the theta component.
Yeah, yeah.
So you take the total energy of the plasma and then keep computing it as a function of distance, and then you will see that.
Total
electromagnetic energy
of the system, E square plus B square, like that. And
kinetic energy of the plasma.
Kinetic energy of the plasma, where we can calculate. We get the density rho and multiply it with the drift velocity.
No. So all this is happening because you have assumed that the inertial mass of particles is zero.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So you can produce velocity without expending any kinetic energy.
Right.
Okay. But you can put small inertial mass and then you can compute the kinetic energy.
But say I know the density rho here, right?
Yeah.
It's a charge density.
This is a charge density.
Yes. Now, I can convert it to the number density by dividing by E and I...
No, that you cannot, that's what I just said.
Probably I didn't understand. How do you do that then?
It is rho by E times the multiplicity factor. Right? So there could be...
rho by E gives me the number of charges.
No, it doesn't give you the number of charges. It gives you the difference in the number density of two charges, two signs of charges.
Yes.
But when you're talking about the actual plasma, it is actual number density that matters.
Right.
Right. So you have n plus minus n minus.
Yes.
Times E. Mm. Actually, I should do the okay. So minus is equal to your rho.
Yes.
Right. But the mass density is n plus
that's n minus.
N minus.
Same mass of electrons.
Times n. So, knowing this does not give you this.
Yeah.
So, this is the multiplicity factor. Right? So, in the rho by E, let's say we call this n. And n plus n minus is capital N. So capital N by small n is the multiplicity. And this solution will work in the regime of large multiplicity and small inertial mass, small rest mass.
Small is not using electron rest mass but something smaller? Or...
No, you can use electron rest mass also as long as you have this. The energy density in the inertial mass is much less than The magnetic energy density.
So multiplicity have to take a very small value as a parameter because we don't have the information of n plus plus n minus.
So no, so you cannot have a very large multiplicity because then you violate this.
Yeah. So what
you cannot have a very small multiplicity because then you will get you will not be in the plasma region. So you have to be somewhere in between.
So what are the range for this solution? Mm-hmm. What would be the range in which the solution work?
So I have not. This is something you can work out.
Okay.
I have not put the numbers to check, but you can take a look and figure out what is the range of multiplicity that you can allow for this solution to operate.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a good point to stop. We'll stop today, and then next class we'll see where are the analogies with the DARPA solution.